Thank you, Dr. Popovic. Can you hear me? It's okay? So the previous presentation was exactly a good introduction to my presentation. I fully agree with the concept of Joao, and we hope that the Porto device will help us a lot in terms of research and comprehension about this rotation instability, which is something absolutely crucial, especially in football field. So now the question on a practical point of view, I mean in the daily life, the question is this lateral extra-articular tenodesis, maybe some of you don't know that, and I will try to explain you the concept. And is it safe and efficient to do it? So it means, is it interesting to do it, or do we have to forget this lateral extra-articular tenodesis? So if we talk about the ACL tears, we know that it's a frequent and challenging issue for return to sport and even long-term and sometimes short-term osteoarthritis. And to be honest, if we ask the question, are we capable to restore the normal, and I underline the normal knee kinematics after an ACL tear, and Joao already mentioned that, I think we must be honest, probably not yet. We are still a chamber of improvement, and we must admit that. And if you look at one of these recent publications, which is a bit worrying for us, because we are very happy, we improve a lot the ACL reconstruction during these last 20 years, but if you look at this one of the publications, but this one was from the so-called Moon group, you know that after ACL reconstruction in soccer, so in football, we are talking about the same topic, only 72% resume soccer, football, about 1 year, which is really sad, and after surgery, and 85% of those returning to the same, or of those patients return to the same or the higher level of play. So don't be too pretentious. We have still to improve. Maybe you can find better series, lower series, I don't know. But in general, we must admit with experience that we have still to improve. And this is the topic, one of the topics today, and this is a challenge. So ACL reconstruction by itself is still a challenge. If we look at the single bundle reconstruction, we know that some biomechanical study have shown that even an anatomically very correctly placed ACL graft as a single shape, a single ACL graft, is not able to restore the normal rotational kinematics, and a lot of papers have shown that, and it can explain some failures and early degenerative arthritis. So maybe the solution is a double bundle reconstruction, and you know that it's something very popular, and it has been popular. So by restoring the individual distinct bundles, you know, AM and PL, both anterior and rotational stability should be more accurately addressed. This is a very nice surgery, and I have done a lot as well, but we were a little bit disappointed by this double bundle reconstruction, and some people, and I would say a majority of people involved in this double bundle have abandoned this surgery, not all of them. So it's probably a promising technique, but still controversial. Maybe we have to improve the technique, but it's still not the panacea and the perfect solution. And in addition, you know, just to complicate the situation and the discussion, a Polish guy, Robert Smigielki, show us that by a very nice dissection, and if you want to read more, you can read in Aspetal Journal, we have a very nice paper from him. He developed the concept of a ribbon bond concept, so even we thought that it was a double bundle, and now someone is telling, no, 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 it's not a double bundle, it's a band. So now difficult to know how to restore, how to do, because even on in term of anatomy, we even don't know exactly what is the anatomy of the ACL. It's a pity, but we have to admit that. So it's a very complex ligament that we have to study. And imagine to restore it and to rebuild this kind of ACL graft, it's very difficult. So what is the solution? Double bundle, single anatomic reconstruction, fractally bound concept? I don't know. Maybe what are the solutions? Maybe what are the solutions? There is maybe not one solution as some people can think about ACL, because I believe that each patient is different. It was already mentioned by Joao, for example. Why some ACL tear have pivot shift and some other not for the complete tear? Why rotational laxity gets worse over time after untreated ACL tear? How to explain this so-called second fracture? And what about the lateral condyle and tibial bone bruise? I would like to give you, take your attention about this. You know, if you look at three standard complete isolated ACL tear, you see the bone bruise is very different from one to another one. So it means, you know, this one is much more posterior. This one is on the lateral compartment, you know. And this one is more anterior, small. This one is big, you know, even with a sort of deformation of the bone. Here it's another kind of bone bruise. And if you look at cautiously, remember, you will see that it's very different from one to another one. So clearly, it's variable. Probably it's variable because the injury is different, and maybe it can depend on the knee. During the lateral tibial plateau subluxation, you know, this is one of the examples I showed you previously. You know the bone bruise here, bone bruise here. What does it mean? It means during 1 second, or maybe less than 1 second, you must be sure that the tibia was in front of the femur in that position. How can we imagine that with lateral tibial plateau translation, how can we imagine that the lateral anterolateral structure cannot be damaged? So this is something that we have to think about. And probably, if we have a patient with an ACL tear following a hyperextension, we will not have the same damage and the same mechanism. So this is something that we have to think, and this is based on this rationale, I would say, we have some people who have worked in anatomy and biomechanics. This was the first, I think, from Philippe Neret, study, an anatomical study about this so-called anterolateral ligament. You know, the majority of you have heard about that. It's a ligament that we should have missed in the past, apparently, because we didn't pay attention on this ligament. And if you look at, sorry about that, if you look at on the on this image, you can see that there are some true ligaments in some knees, not all of them, and it has been extensively studied with different teams, and already we know that there is still a controversy. So nobody is up, I mean, some people think that the ligament is like that, some other it's different, so it's not, still not clear, but at least there is something, there is some anterolateral structure that can play a role in the rotational control. So we have to look at that more cautiously. And if you look at the same study, the first study from Philippe, it's interesting to see that when the tibia is translated anteriorly, the anterolateral ligament becomes taut and takes a more oblique path anteroinferiorly toward the tibia. So it's interesting that there is something. I don't believe personally that there is only an ALL. The problem is there is a global anterolateral structure that we maybe underestimate in some patients, not all of them. And where is the real anterolateral ligament? We don't know, I told you, but it's interesting to see this study, recent study in 2015, where people show that if we compare ALL reconstruction, because some people have started to reconstruct the anterolateral ligament, the modified Lemaire technique, which is a traditional one already empirically used in this anterolateral laxity, seems to be much more efficient, and we can understand because the obliquity of the procedure is probably more efficient to control the anterolateral laxity. So you see that we don't have the answer. That there is something probably that we have to discuss and think about. So how to better control this pivot shift? You know, because at the end of the day, we are not the patient, the football player is not talking about Lachman, he's complaining this. The thing that you can see by clinical examination even better in the operating theater is complaining instability. Instability means pivot shift. So if you do your best ACL reconstruction intra-articular and if there is still a pivot shift, it's a problem for the football player and the athlete in general. And we think that lateral tenosis is one of the options, not probably the only one, one of the good options to compensate this rotational instability. The aim is to really control the rotation. It's like a brake. You have to, if you look at this super view of the from the plane of the knee, you have to control the rotation. It means the anterior translation of the lateral compartment, lateral tibia, which is the one which is moving during the pivot shift. In other words, when your patient, when your athlete has an instability, this is exactly what happened. So we have to control that if we cannot control only with the ACL. So just I would like to show you some sort of demonstration how to understand this kind of thing, how to control a rotation. This is a right knee. This is a right knee. We can consider that like it's like a door. So look at the door. one of the doors in hospital. We have the hinge, which is here. The handle is here. So it can be comparable, even if it is not exactly like that, because the center of rotation is more medial. But let's say rotation of the knee is in the middle of the knee. So it means this part will move more than this part. This part will rotation, and this part will move more anteriorly. This is like a door. So if you keep the comparison with the door, how do you do if you want to stop the door? So you use a wedge. So either you use the wedge on the close to the handle, or you use the wedge close to the hinge. You don't need to be a big biomechanical specialist to understand that this one is less efficient. By the way, in this example, you know, the person who helped me to do it had to hold the door with the hand, because it couldn't hold the door only with this small edge. But this one was very efficient. Why? Because it's a better lever arm. So in my opinion, it could be compared to the lateral tenodesis, where you have a better lever arm to control the rotation of your knee. And probably the medial edge could be compared to the double bundle if we try to compare the knee with this bundle. So few images of surgery, because it's always interesting for the non-surgeon to see how we do, because usually we show arthroscopy and we do a lot of arthroscopy, but this surgery is open surgery. We can do that with smaller incision that was done in the past. You know, you open on the lateral part, you approach the iliotibial band, you see this longitudinal fibers, which was the one that you have to take the posterior part of the iliotibial band. Don't harvest this one, which is going to the lateral part of the patella. And we simply harvest with a knife like that a band, so a part of the iliotibial band, and you make a new graph, which is a natural graph, of course. And you can do that by playing with the window of the approach. You can easily harvest this part that you have to leave attached to the GRD tubercle distally. And here, under the skin, you can just use, you know, simple instrument to harvest this graph, which must be at least 10 centimeters. It's depending on the size of the patient, of course. But 12 centimeters is safe, 10 centimeters is the minimum for a smaller guy. So you know, you have this kind of graph, which is still attached to the GRD. You free until the GRD, but don't detach from the GRD, of course, because the plan is to use it to control the rotation and the translation of the lateral tibial plateau. You measure, and usually we are happy if we have, you know, in this case, it's 12 centimeters, 12, 13, so it's, we're happy with that. Then the next step is to approach the lateral collateral ligament, which can be palpated, and then approach easily with this kind of electrocautery. And the plan is to pass the graft under the LCL, because the LCL will give you the isometric point to control the rotation. So then you just have to approach the lateral part of the femur. For those who are not comfortable, here is the epicondyle. You know, the femur is here, the tibia is here, it's the right knee. And we approach the lateral part of the femur just above the epicondyle. So we just have to remove a part of the what's the so-called Kaplan fibers. And then, with a very nice instrument that teach me Mark Martens, an experimental surgeon who is doing this kind of surgery. And because you know, this kind of surgery is the result of a combination of a different technique that you can find all over the world. And you improve your technique, and then you approach, and you can see very well after this small vessel here, which marks exactly the place where you have to be. The epicondyle is here. The intermuscular septum is posterior, so you have to stay anterior to the intermuscular septum, and this is the place where we will put the graft. We will fix the graft. So to do so, we have different technique, but this techniques we will use in Asvetar is this one. You can do a tunnel, you can do everything, but this one has the advantage to be very simple. We make osteoperiosteal bridge. So you just mark with the electrocautery on the lateral part, and we have the chance, because on this part of the femur, the periosteum is very thick, especially in young population, but even it's less young. a bit sick, so you can harvest and prepare a nice bridge to pass the graft underneath and to have a bone integration of this graft for the future. So we use this simple osteotome, so it's nice to do this when you are arthroscopic surgeon to do sometimes some open surgery with kind of traditional instrument. So it's easy to perform and easy to use. And then when the bridge, you know, we like to do this osteopastoral bridge to get bone integration of the graft, otherwise it could slide and it could stretch in the future. But with this, it's though then we just have to take the graft, to pass the graft under the lateral collateral ligament, which is again be the isometric point of the fixation. So we pass the graft, then we pass the graft from the second tunnel. Let's say the first tunnel is under the LCL, lateral collateral ligament, the second tunnel is under this osteoperosteal tunnel. So we pass the graft easily like that, and then we have just to fix it like traditionally with staples. So the question is now to know what kind of tension and what kind of position of the knee is advice. This is important to be not too overcorrect. So we ask the assistant to put in a very slight external rotation, 30 degree of flexion where we have usually the pivot shift, and we fix the graft with the osteoperosteal bridge. You know, it makes the fixation very strong, and then we just have to revert and to put back the graft on itself. This is the reason it's better to have a 10 or 12 centimeter of length and with a very strong suture, we suture the graft to itself. So, you know, it's a simple procedure which doesn't need any specific instrumentation. It's not only a concept, which is quite modified if you compare the concept of Lemaire or McIntosh a few years ago, where they did an extensive lateral approach. We can do that with a similar approach, and then we close the iliotibial band to avoid any hernia. And finally, the concept is this one. You have this traction of the graft, which allow you to break, to control the rotation and the anterior translation of the lateral tibial plateau. I think you have understood the rule. So now, what is the efficiency? To come back to the title, is it efficient? Is it safe? First, is it efficient in vitro? We always start with in vitro, the study. So it can protect the intra-articular graft during the graft healing phase, because if you look at this landmark publication from Engelbretsen in 1990, he demonstrated that in vitro, this lateral tenodesis, in addition to the ACL intra-articular graft, decrease the force going through an intra-articular construction by 43% in vitro. It's not nothing. This information is very important, because if you want to put back your football player on the field, I'm more comfortable if it is a high-level athlete, if there is a lateral tenodesis in addition to protect my graft. So the answer is probably yes, in vitro it seems to be good. So now, is it efficient in ACL reconstruction in the real life? We start to have different evidence and different papers supporting the fact that there is no difference, to be honest, between in terms of IKDC between the two groups. But all the study, and this one is the last one, which was end of 2015, it showed that there is a statistically significant reduction in pivot shift in favor of the combined procedure, ACL graft plus lateral tenodesis. I'm happy with that, because my role and my mission is to put back the patient on the field and to avoid any pivot shift. So if we are better with the lateral tenodesis, I think it's a good thing. So yes, it works in terms of control of pivot shift. Even in ACL revision, we have now some studies showing that there is difference and increase knee stability, especially the rotation laxity. So yes, even in this challenging situation, which are the ACL revision, the extra-articular tenodesis works. Finally, is it safe? I would refer to this meta-analysis, which was done in 2015. So you know, all these papers are very recent. Only RCT, and they show that there is no difference in terms of complication between the two groups. And if we look at this world studying now and our fellow, previous fellow Shima is welcome from Japan. He came back for the meeting. He is working on this study comparing the two groups alone and with extra-articular tenodesis, and we don't see any difference in terms of outcomes during the first 6 months. So in other words, if you want to do extra-articular tenodesis, feel free, because it will not increase the morbidity of your surgery. So yes, we can say it's safe. So in summary, I would say that for us, we believe that the lateral tenodesis is a very good tool combined with ACL reconstruction. It's not a universal technique, a universal tool, but it's one of the additional tools that we can use in the big laxity or important level for the patient, because it improves the control of the pivot shift and it protects the intra-articular ACL graft. Thank you very much for your attention.